this is chapter 4, original edition, section 2, teaching and learning, paragraph 8, that starts, you believe that if you allow no change to enter into your ego. All right, do you see it? All right. Okay, so in this, so I'll just go ahead and read it and then we'll get into it. It says, you believe that if you allow no change to enter into your ego, that your soul will find peace, okay? So, interesting sentence. We believe, or the human mind believes, that if we don't change and we don't learn, that our soul will find peace. If we don't change, just keep everything the same, just keep everything the same, keep everything the same, no change, where our soul will find peace. That's what the human mind, the ego, believes. So when it says you believe that, do you suppose it's talking to us? Okay. So it didn't say you, da-da-da, it says you. All right. And he says that, so in other words, there's a part of me that believes if I just don't change my mind, if I just keep things the same, then it'll all be okay. My soul will find peace, right? This is the part of us that resists learning. This is the part of us that resists change. Is anybody aware of the part of themselves that resists change? Okay, so the Course in Miracles in this section equates learning and change. Learning means change. Change means learning. If you want to learn, it means to change. You must change. Change your thoughts. Change your thoughts. And if you want to learn, it means change. And if you want to change, how are you going to change? If there's something you want to change, something you want to change, that means then there's something you need to learn. Okay? But learning and change means opening up your mind and questioning what you already believe. And that's what we will want to do. Okay? In the earlier part of this, he says many people stand guard over their thought systems. Many people stand guard over their thought systems because they are afraid to change, right? And so, and we know what it's like to be talking to somebody who's standing guard over their thought system, their beliefs. And we also know what it feels like to stand guard over our own thought system because we don't want to hear anything new. We only want to hear what we already believe. I only want to hear what I already believe, even if I'm miserable. And we've all talked to somebody who's unhappy, and it's obvious that what they believe is making them unhappy, but when we offer them a change of thought or attitude, what do? They resist. They defend. They already tried that. I already did that. Oh, that didn't work for me. Oh, that's for somebody else. Okay? So he says that the reason that some people stand guard over their thought system, even though their thought system obviously has not made them happy, is that they are afraid of change. They are afraid of change. Okay? Have you ever been in a conversation with somebody like that? They're very unhappy. You offer them a new way of looking at it, and they defend against it. They defend. Anybody experienced that? Okay. That is somebody who's afraid to learn a new way of thinking because they are afraid of change, okay? Even though the way they think and feel right now is not making them happy. And then earlier in this section, our teacher explained why we are afraid of new ideas even though our old ideas are not making us happy. We're afraid to hear new ideas, to learn and to change, because we're afraid of change because our first experience of change was from heaven, the oneness, bliss of being with God, the universe, into a body, okay? So our first experience of change was not particularly pleasant. It wasn't a good one, okay? That original change that the Course calls the separation or the detour to fear or the fall. Those are all synonyms, detour into fear, separation, the fall. But he says the best term, though, is the separation, okay? The time when we chose separation instead of unity. Instead of oneness, I don't want that. I'm not interested in oneness. I would like something just for me, Just for me, just for me. See this? This is just for me, right? Okay, that's the fall, that's the separation. That was our first experience of change. We went from the bliss of unity, no needs, no lack, no death, no fear, into this, okay? A world full of death, fear, separation, and lack, right? Okay, so that's why we're afraid of change. And so, because we're afraid of change, we're really afraid of learning. We're afraid of learning, right? What does that mean? It means I'm afraid to hear something new. I'm afraid to hear something I don't already think, even if what I think now is not making me happy at all, okay? So, learning means change, all right? So then it says, what was that? Let's see what that says. So you believe that if you allow no change to enter into your ego, you believe that if you don't allow any learning to occur, then your soul will find peace. Okay, can anybody relate to that about their own ego? All right. And he says, this profound confusion is possible only if a person maintains that the same thought system can stand on two foundations. But nothing can reach the soul from the ego, and nothing from the soul can strengthen the ego or reduce the conflict within the ego. Why is that? That's because the ego is a contradiction. What does that mean? That means man's self and God's self are in opposition. Man's self and God's self are opposed in creation, in will, and in outcome. Hey, Billy, would you be willing to shut the door? Maybe even say something to those girls? Yeah. Tell them to laugh quietly. And no slamming of doors. Sick Billy on. Go get him.
What are they doing here? They sound like
they're playing. I know. I was like, well, what's that sound?
Playing.
Hey, Pat. Okay. So then it's saying that man's self and God's self are in opposition. That means opposed in creation and will and outcome, because man's self and God's self are fundamentally irreconcilable. Why is that? That's because the soul cannot perceive and the ego cannot know. And therefore, the man's self, meaning the self we made, the man-made self, and God's self, they are therefore not in communication and can never be in communication. Nevertheless, the ego can learn, because the ego's making... Hey, Billy, we shut those doors behind you, and thank you. Okay, so it says, nevertheless, the ego can learn, because the ego's maker can be misguided, but cannot make the totally lifeless out of the life given. In other words, the soul need not be taught, but the ego must. Okay. Blah, 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 blah. Is that what y'all heard too? Mm-hmm. All right, thank you. Okay. So it's like this. Why is it that what is the profound confusion that we are suffering from? We have this profound confusion that goes something like this. If I don't change my mind, I'll be happy. If I just don't allow any change to occur, if I just don't allow myself to learn anything new, then I'll be happy. I'll find peace. All right? He says, that is a profound confusion. But you know that we do experience that, or else we'd have no resistance to learning. We'd have no resistance to learning. Okay? But he says, this profound confusion comes from this belief that the same thought system can stand on two foundations. What does that mean? That means that we have this profound confusion that goes something like this. That I can keep the way that I think now and have the peace that I don't have now. That I can keep the way I think now and the way I see it now and have peace. That's the profound confusion that we have, right? That I can keep my old way of thinking but have a peaceful future. He says that's a profound confusion. You cannot keep the thought system that you have now, especially if it hasn't made you blissed out, or consistently happy at least, and have peace, or have a peaceful, happy future, or now, okay? He says that's our profound confusion. And the reason is because the ego and man's self, the ego, and God's self, they are not in communication. In other words, the ego is not talking to God, and God's self is not talking to our ego. They are opposed. Because what are they doing? Man's self and God's self, they're both denying that the other one exists. Right? God's self is going like, what ego? I didn't create an ego, therefore it must not be exist. And the ego is like, what God? What God's self? I'm God. So the man's self and God's self are not in communication, he said, which is interesting. He says, but even though they're not in communication with each other, the ego still can learn. And the ego's got to be taught. Okay? And why is it that the ego can be taught? Well, the ego can be taught because you made it and you can be taught. Okay? So isn't that interesting? So the ego is not God's self. It doesn't know God's self. It doesn't hear God's self. But it can be taught. The ego can learn. And that's really what this is all about. Okay? This is about the ego, which is interesting. All we're doing here is teaching the ego. That's what A Course in Miracles is. Isn't that interesting? It's just teaching the ego. What does teaching mean? Learning the ego. What does learning the ego mean? Changing. Because remember, change means learning, and learning means change. So this is a curriculum in teaching the ego, learning it, teaching it, or changing it, which is another way of saying evolving it, right? Because our real self, our soul, it doesn't need to be taught. My soul already has all knowledge. It's only my ego that's pretending like, what knowledge? So only my ego needs to be taught. Only my ego needs to change. And that's what we're doing here, okay? And remember, it says, so it's interesting. So here's ego, here's man's self. The ego, here's God's self. They do not talk to each other because they're both in denial of each other. But then there's this bridge that's in our mind. And that bridge is called the Holy Spirit, right? Or our loving right mind. Okay? Then interesting. Okay, so the important thing here, one of the important things here to me, for me that's very practical, is that if there's any area of my life right now where I'm not happy consistently, then that's the area that I need change. Which means that's the area where I need learning. So it's like this. If you want to change, it comes from learning. So instead of going, okay, how can I rearrange the externals of this situation, instead of trying to change the externals, move around the furniture, what I really wanted to ask myself is, am I willing to learn a new way of seeing myself? Am I willing to learn something new in this situation about myself? Am I willing to learn? Am I willing to question what I have been believing about myself, about this situation? Am I willing to question what I believe right now and open my mind to hearing something and learning something new that I'm not thinking right now? Now, that is the question, and that is the attitude that will produce real change in any given situation. So to me, that's really useful, really practical, because that tells me exactly what to do if I really need a change. If I'm really, really tired of the misery and the suffering that I'm doing in this area, then now I know how to have an improvement. Now I know a way and a method of having peace in that area. Okay, now, to the extent that I am unhappy in any area of my life, and I am not willing to look at what I'm thinking,
excuse me,
and open my mind for another way of seeing it or thinking about it, to the extent that I resist that process, excuse me, to that extent, I don't want to change. To that extent, I'm afraid to change, right? And there are some areas of my life where even though I am suffering miserably, I'm still more afraid of changing. Isn't that sad? Aw, right? I'm miserable in this area of life. I can't get it right. Seems like it's just working the same pattern over and over and over in money and over and over in relationships, the same pattern. It goes the same way. And I end up unhappy, right? And, you know, but then for some reason I notice that I'm not opening my mind up to look at what it is I'm believing about money or relationships or the body, and opening my mind up to seeing it a new way and learning something new about it. And I notice I'm not motivated for some reason to do that. Why is that? Okay, I'm suffering over here. I've learned that change means learning something new, but I'm really not motivated to learn something new, a new way of looking at it. What's up with that? According to this, that means that I am more afraid of the change than I am of the misery. Okay, can we admit that there is a part of us that is more afraid of change than it is of being unhappy? Anyone? Okay, all right. Well, in whatever area of your life that you are unhappy or dissatisfied, but you notice you are not doing anything about it relative to your thoughts, that's the place where you know that, in this area I'm okay with the misery. I mean, it sucks. It's not comfortable. But it sure as hell beats change. It sure as hell beats questioning what I'm thinking right now about this particular topic. Right? Now, if we were to say that to ourselves one time about one area that we struggle in, you would be on the road to change. You would be on the road to a new experience in that particular area. Wow, interesting.
So what's next?
Okay, so what's
I
next?
Mean, I've got that far. Mm-hmm. I admit all this.
Okay.
How do you get past that?
Right, and that is at that point, that's when you say, wow, I don't like the way I feel in this area. I don't like the way I feel. God, I hope I'm wrong. And then, like we were talking about last week, that's when you do your inventory, you know, about what it is you are telling yourself about this particular topic. And then you tell yourself, God, I hope I'm wrong, because I don't like the way those thoughts are making me feel. I want another way of seeing this. I want another way of seeing myself relative to money, the body, relationships, etc. And then I ask for another way, then you ask the higher mind for another way. So basically, you're saying, higher mind, I am so willing to learn a new way of seeing this. I am so willing, teach me, please. And then now your mind is open to learning. And what happens within a mind that's open to learning? Real change. Not fake change, real change. What is real change? Fundamental change. Wow. To me, that's really important because there are some areas of my life, I feel like I've been rearranging the furniture, I've been rearranging the external circumstances over and over and over and over, and I still keep getting the same result, unhappiness. And so, when I'm hearing, I see why nothing changed. I wasn't doing anything different. Oh, this is a way to bring that about. It's a relief because now I know what to do.
So let me see if I understand this. If there's an area where I'm really unhappy, then I just need to say to myself, it's because I'm more scared to change
yes.
than I am of the
yes.
of the misery.
Absolutely. I mean, if one time you said about your misery in any particular area, if you said, wow, this is what I prefer to learning. Wow, okay, I want this. I want this. This is my preference. If you were to say that one time, then you would, things would change right then and there. But the most people don't want change that bad, where they're willing to say, wow, I'm miserable right now because that's my preference, because it's better than opening my mind to learning and to change, and this is my preference. I like, you know, I want this. I mean, if you said that one time, because that is the one thing people do not say about their negative emotions, whereas that's the one truth that is true about them. You know, this is my preference to hearing something new and opening my mind and questioning my beliefs around this and asking for another way of seeing it. Wow, isn't that deep?
Yeah.
There's the one thing people don't say about their unhappiness. They don't say, wow, this is my preference. Look at that. How very interesting. Call for love. Yes.
Could that be out of fear of being wrong?
Yes.
Like the threat to the ego?
What we were saying before you came in was we were doing a little recap from last week's section and then the earlier parts of this particular section. It was saying that we are afraid, the human mind is afraid of change. The human mind is afraid of change because the human mind's first change was from the no lack of unity to the lack of separateness. Okay? So the human mind is afraid of change. The ego is afraid of change. Okay? So that's what we're afraid of. So the human mind is more afraid of change than it is of the misery. Another way of saying that is, we are more afraid of happiness than we are of unhappiness, okay? If I'm unhappy more consistently than I am happy, then it has to mean I am more afraid of being happy than I am afraid of being unhappy. Because it can't be otherwise. It can't be that you're unhappy because that's the real nature of reality. It cannot be that. It has to mean you are afraid of reality. You're afraid of the truth. You're afraid to change your mind. Because that's where happiness resides or waits for you. Mm-hmm.
So, like in the areas where I'm like really unhappy, like if I tell myself and I believe, oh, I can't change this because I'm incapable. Mm-hmm. Is that just like another way of saying I prefer not to change?
Absolutely. Thank you for saying that. If you're telling yourself I'm incapable of changing, it has to mean that you are more afraid of change than you are of being miserable. And if just tell yourself that, be honest with yourself 1 second, and say that give yourself the truth, even if. You know, the next minute you go back to saying, God, I wish this worked. You know, God, I wish I could be happy, but I can't, right? You know, just tell yourself the truth. You know, it can't be that you can't change your mind. It cannot be. That's, your mind can be many things, but it cannot be impervious to the decision to learn, ever. The mind cannot ever lose that ability. Your mind cannot lose the ability to learn, which means to change. No matter what happens to me, I can always change my mind, and there is nothing in heaven or earth that can take away my power to change my mind, to say, I'm going to change my mind, right? So in this case, we're saying, I want to change my mind. I want to learn anew because I do not like the way I feel right now. And even though I'm afraid to change, I'm afraid to open my mind and hear something I don't believe right now, Even though I'm afraid of that, I can't take the misery anymore. I can't take it anymore.
Well, isn't some of our, when you explain it all, it's real easy. It makes no sense not to choose happiness. But isn't our real belief is, okay, I'm miserable now, but this change is going to be more painful than
yes,
my current
exactly.
misery.
Exactly. Thank you for saying that.
So that's what really, we don't think we're going to trade for happiness, or we would.
That's exactly right.
We think it's going to be worse than the misery.
That's right. Thank you for saying that. That's what it says in the earlier paragraphs of this section, that we do believe that change means it's going to be worse, because that was our first experience of change. It went from good to worse. So now we believe all change is from something, from this to worse.
What we're trying to do is change that belief. And since that's our belief, that's difficult.
That's right. That's exactly right.
That's where they learn that the change
comes in. Thank you for saying that.
Well, when I was a little kid, I used to visit, go to our aunt's place, house. And she had on the wall this little prayer. And I can't remember exactly what it said, but I'm sure other people have seen it. It's something about, please, Lord, help me to accept those things that I can... accept those things that I cannot change. Mm-hmm. And then there's two other lines before that. I don't know.
That's the serenity prayer.
Yeah. The serenity prayer.
The things Lord, accept the things
I cannot change.
I cannot change.
Courage to change the things I can.
Or give me the courage to change the things I can. The acceptance
the wisdom to know the difference.
And the wisdom.
The acceptance to...
The things that I cannot change.
Yeah, the things I can't change.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the wisdom to know the difference.
So I'm sitting... I as a little kid, I used to read that.
Yeah, it's
great. I was like, oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah,
I guess that's
good.
Some law you live by.
Thank you.
Bill W.'s credo.
It never seems to really sink in that well.
Say that again?
That serenity prayer never seems to sink in that well.
And why do you suppose that is?
It goes a little bit against people's nature.
For sure, the human mind nature. Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Because remember, the human mind's nature is to resist change, which means to resist learning. Okay? So that's something very, very important we need to know about the human mind, aka the human ego. The ego. It, by its nature, resists change. And it goes on to say later why it is that the ego resists change, okay? Because it says later that the ego is afraid of change because the ego knows that eventually change, aka learning, is going to lead to the relinquishment of it. And that's why the ego doesn't want it. So let's just go ahead and say, my human mind resists learning and it resists change because my ego knows that eventually if I keep opening my mind to learning and keep opening my mind to change instead of rigidly standing guard over what I believe now and not opening it to question, that eventually that will lead me to question the ego, which is the end of the ego. And to the ego, that's death. Me questioning my ego is me eventually relinquishing my ego and going, what the hell is, how is the ego serving me? That's silly, I don't want that anymore. I changed my mind.
So we're comfortable in our misery because we don't know what's out there. And it's like, well, at least you're here, you know what it is.
Yes.
Out there, it's like, well, I don't know,
Exactly.
I need to stay here.
Exactly. That's exactly right. And that's exactly what the ego, the human mind ego, has got to tell us. It has to say to us, don't change because you don't know what's out there. You don't know what could be. You don't know what's out there. So stay here. Stay safe. Don't change. Don't question the way it is now. Why does the ego say that? Not because the change is going to be worse. It's because the ego knows if you open your mind up enough and question what you've been believing and thinking, eventually you're going to go, why the hell am I listening to that ego? What do I want that ego? What do I want that voice for? And then you will relinquish it. And to the ego, that's death. He says the ego does not share. Our teacher in here goes, the ego doesn't share my charity. So the ego's not like our teacher. The ego's not going to go, oh, well, thanks for letting me rule your brain and your mind for all this millennia. Thanks so much. I'll just be on my way since you don't need me anymore. The ego will not, does not see you not needing it anymore as a good thing. Your ego's never going to go, oh, you don't need me anymore. Okay, bye. Thanks for letting me control your consciousness for all these years. Thanks for letting me control you. You know, the ego doesn't share the charity of our teacher, who will be thrilled when you no longer need him. Right? Our teacher, the loving right mind, Holy Spirit, is thrilled when we no longer need it, because we've allowed our mind to be changed and unified with love. Okay?
So, I find that when I get really close to the truth, and I start like the rays of the truth start shining on me, I find like this, the best way to describe it is this insatiable neediness come up within me.
Yes.
And it's like trying to like hold on for dear life.
Exactly.
And I just got an aha from what you were saying, because I always identified with that as that being me, but that's actually my ego.
That's right, that's exactly right. It's your ego panicking. It's your ego seeing you going, do I really need the ego? Do I really want to follow that voice? Hey, is that voice even real? And the ego begins to panic because it sees that not as you relinquishing the ego, it sees that as death. It sees that as the ego sees you giving up your ego as death, not just you relinquishing it. You know, and so it's true. And then it goes on to talk about, so exactly what we're saying, it goes on to say, it says, here's the ultimate reason why learning is perceived as frightening. And remember, learning means change. Here is the ultimate reason why learning or change is perceived as frightening. It's because of this. It's because learning does lead to the relinquishment, in parentheses, not destruction, of the ego to what? To the light of the soul. And that's the change the ego must fear. Why? Because the ego doesn't share my charity, says our teacher. And our teacher then says, my lesson was like yours. And because I learned it, I can now teach my lesson. And then our teacher says to us, I never attack your egos, but I do try to teach you how your ego's thought system arose. And, says our teacher, when I remind you of your true creation, your egos cannot but respond with fear. So that's exactly what you were talking about, Chris. Okay, so here's where learning always leads. Learning always leads to the relinquishment of the ego. Learning that is of light, learning that is of truth. Okay? Now, if it's, quote, learning of fear, that's not learning. That's just the same old, same old, same old, right? That's just a regurgitation of the same old, same old. That's not learning. Doesn't learning always imply the acceptance of something new? Doesn't learning always mean the taking in of something new, right? So if you're learning fear or guilt, that's not learning. That's repetition. That's a repetition compulsion. That's not learning. Okay, so learning, which means the taking in of something new, always leads you to the point where you give up your ego, right? And the ego's not as charitable as our teacher. So the ego's not thrilled when you don't need it anymore. The ego's not charitable like that. Whereas our teacher, when you go, all right, teacher, I only decide for peace. I only let truth decide for peace for me. Thank you, I don't need you anymore. Our teacher goes, beautiful, congratulations, right on. You've graduated. I'm so proud of you, right? That's what our teacher does. But the ego doesn't share that charity. Now, And it says, then our teacher says this, look, I'll never attack your ego. So don't worry about learning. You know, we have this fear of change. We have this fear of opening our mind to hear the new. We're afraid to open our mind to hear something new, something we hadn't been thinking about these situations we're struggling in. We're afraid to hear something new. I don't want to hear something I don't believe. We're afraid to hear something new, but our teacher says this, look, I'm not going to attack your ego. I don't attack your ego. Don't be afraid to learn anew. Don't be afraid to hear something new, because when you hear something new, it's not going to be an attack on your ego. So when you hear your teacher teaching you something new about this old problem, your teacher is not going to be doing this, you're so slow. I can't believe, how many times do I have to go over this with you? Didn't I tell you last week that you are innocent? Didn't I tell you last week that there is no sin, there is no guilt, right? So, see, we're afraid to learn. We're afraid to go, hey, teach me. Obviously, I'm wrong. I don't know. We're afraid because we're afraid that we're going to be attacked, right? Isn't that basically why we're afraid to ask? Yes.
So then, okay, you've got the teacher who is non-threatening and not going to threaten your ego, and you accept that. So what are the other ways to brace yourself or to like bolster yourself so that you can take on that challenge?
By letting yourself hear this truth, by letting your teacher tell you, I don't attack your ego.
But let's say it's by yourself.
There's nothing to bolster yourself against. You know, you only need to bolster yourself and get yourself ready if you're going to be attacked.
But isn't part of the problem yourself? Like if you're learning something by yourself or trying to, like the obstacle is you.
Yeah.
So how do you bolster yourself from that perceived threat when there's no teacher in the picture?
Well, if there's no teacher in the picture besides your own ego,
yeah, yourself,
then all you're going to get is attack.
Oh.
Yeah, because you trying to be your own teacher is attack. That's you attacking yourself, right? Saying like this, I don't need to learn from no higher mind. Whatever I think is the way it is, I'll tell myself the way it is in this situation. That's an attack. That's you attacking yourself, and that's your ego attacking you, and you siding with it. Yeah. So, you know, it is an attack to teach yourself. You know, to not say, wow, I need to be taught because obviously I don't know the truth here. How do I know? Because I'm suffering. Obviously I'm doing it wrong. Obviously I don't know what I'm doing. How do I know? Because I am not happy. And so I must not be doing it right. I must not know the truth. And I need to be taught. But you know, the adult ego is so offended by the idea that it needs to be taught. We're so like, oh, I'm an adult, man. I went to school, I went to college, I am this old. Yeah, I don't need to be taught anything. I'm not a learner. That's insulting. The ego finds that very, the adult ego finds that very insulting. You know, which is really just the beautiful, beautiful, beautiful ego attack, an ego defense against learning. So when the ego is afraid that you may learn enough to realize it's a freaking illusion, then the ego goes, you know, you're an adult. Don't ask for help. You're an adult. Don't say you don't know. Don't say that, right? That's what the ego says. Don't say you don't know. Don't say you're wrong. No self-respecting adult ego says that. Right? That's the ego's best defense against you learning. And then being free from this thing that had been limiting you, the thing you're struggling with forever. Wow. So the last thing the ego wants you to say is, well, obviously I don't know what this means, and obviously I don't know what the truth is in this situation, and obviously I must be wrong, and I need to learn something new here. That's the ego will never allow you to say that. Now you can choose to say that. You can choose to, but the ego will never encourage that. Because the moment that you say that sentence and you have that idea, now your mind is open to hearing something that you had not been thinking. Your mind is open to learning. And as soon as your mind is opening to learn something new, then you, what will occur, what is inevitable, is that at some point you will go, I don't want the ego. I don't need it. I don't want it. No, thank you. And then you're free. Yes.
Well, and I really want to thank you for what you're saying right now, Anna, because I've been doing the course for a while. And, like, sometimes, like, I won't be as diligent in my studying because, like, the thought is like, oh, I've been doing this for a while, so I know it, or I should know it. And then things start falling apart in my life. And then instead of saying, wow, I really don't know this.
As evidenced by how I feel.
Yeah, I really don't know this.
Right.
And I really need to be studying more. I'm like resisting.
Yes.
Exactly. And then I'm like, well, maybe this doesn't work.
Exactly. I mean, that's the height of the ego's arrogance and ignorance is you are unhappy, but your mind is not open to learning. You have this certainty that you know, but yet you're unhappy. That's the ego's capstone, right? Yeah. So you've heard that phrase, pride goeth before the fall.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in this case, it is the idea that you know when you're unhappy goes before the fall.
Mm-hmm.
No, that's the ultimate arrogance. I'm unhappy, but yet and I'm right. Don't tell me that I might not be seeing this correctly. I mean, that's the ultimate in the ego's arrogance, and it's the ultimate defensive mechanism of the ego to keep you from learning, which always leads to the relinquishment of the ego, which means happiness and freedom. Relinquishment of the ego, happiness, freedom. So the ego is always against you learning. Don't learn, don't learn, don't learn. Don't open your mind. Don't question. Don't ask questions. Don't admit you don't know. Don't admit you may be wrong. Don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. Wow.
Is that what the meek are? They're willing to learn?
Thank you. Yes. That's beautiful. The meek shall inherit the earth. That's because their egos are humble. That's what he says in the original edition.
Right.
It says the meek shall inherit the earth because their egos are humble. I love that phrase. That's not in the edited version. And I was like, oh, I love it. Okay, where does strength come from? It's not from not having an ego, because look, if you're here, you're going to have an ego. Like, you don't come here without getting an ego. You don't come here without wanting an ego. That's the ticket in. That's your ticket in. That's your ticket into hell. Okay? You want to come to hell? All right, here's your ego. All right, you want a body? Here's the ego. The ego kind of comes with the body. That doesn't mean you have to keep the ego in charge of it once you get here. But I remember when I heard that phrase here in the original edition, I went, oh, the meek shall inherit the earth because their egos are humble. I was like, okay, all right. So there is a way of having an ego, but having a humble ego. A humble ego. What's a humble ego? That's an ego that's like, okay, I am an ego. You know, I don't know. If I'm not happy, I don't know what's true and what's real. Why? Because reality is happiness. Reality is joy. Reality is peace. So when you say, I don't, maybe I'm wrong, what can I lose by asking? At least I can say I don't like the way I feel right now. That is having a humble ego. That's an ego that can be taught. Remember that last sentence he said? He says the ego, the soul need not be taught, but the ego must. So a humble ego is an ego that is open to learning. Yes, I have an ego. Yes, I know I'm in an ego because I'm in a body. But I am open to being taught.
So then, in other words, I'm always going to be learning from the course to the day that I die. There isn't going to be a day where I'm like, I got this.
Yes.
Oh.
Exactly.
Because then that would go against what you're saying.
Exactly.
That learning.
Exactly.
About learning.
Exactly.
Isn't everything supposed to be like that, though?
Yes. But learning is not the ultimate. Right? There is a period of learning, and then, well, eventually, according to the course, you go beyond learning to creating. Okay? So we're not supposed to be learners into eternity. Right? We're not supposed to be learning into eternity. But he says, learning, like the classrooms in which learning occurs, is temporary. Okay? But you ain't going to get past learning by resisting learning. You know, it's like, yeah, I want to get past having to learn. Oh, I still need to learn. Obviously, there's still something I need to learn. Yeah, I'd like to get past it, but it's not going to happen by pretending that I don't need to learn anymore because I'm an adult. Right? So, but he says that's what we're doing. We're resisting learning. I don't want to be a learner. I want to be the teacher. I don't want to be the learner. I'm 50 years old. I don't want to be the learner. That's for kids. Right?
So is that what we're supposed to learn here? Is that we've found the ego, the defenses, the tricks, the fears, all that stuff.
Yes. It's all...
And I'm miserable.
Right.
Because I taught myself. But here we all are trying to figure out how we're going to get ourselves out of what we got ourselves into.
Exactly.
And one of the answers is we're not.
Right, exactly.
You got yourself here. If you want out, you go outside yourself for help.
If you want to be free from this problem, it means you're going to have to be the learner. And boy, do we have some resistance around that, man. I don't want to be the learner. I'm an adult. I want to tell people what's going on. So, I want to tell myself what's going on.
But the ego likes to keep us learning, too, because it's like, well, I can't go and help the world because I'm not all okay yet, you know. Mm-hmm. And then, so, when we neglect the world, then, you know, the world suffers. Because we're... In a way, the ego keeps us learning. You know, like, I haven't fixed myself totally yet, so I can't go out and help anybody else.
Right, so the ego is saying, you know, I need to keep teaching myself. And until I've taught myself completely, I can't teach anyone else. With the whole premise is faulty.
Yeah.
Which is that the goal is to teach yourself until you don't need teaching anymore so that you can teach someone else. So, faulty premise, trying to teach yourself.
Yeah.
On that point, didn't you say something that we're going to have to take action and stop learning? I mean,
eventually.
Stop just amassing information.
Yes, eventually. But I also was saying that we're not going to get beyond learning while we resist learning, you know. And the Course in Miracles says, you know, don't set your sights beyond learning right now. Don't set your sights beyond learning. You got a lot to learn. You know, you got plenty of learning to do. You know, right now, this curriculum is about learning. You know, allowing your egos to be humble enough to be the learner instead of the teacher. You know, that doesn't mean that you're going to help other people to learn. You know, in this case, you know, teaching means, you know, helping people to learn what you're trying to learn, okay? But, you know, another, but in this case, be patient with being the learner of the teacher, which means the higher mind, okay? So he says, basically, the goal of this curriculum is just learning. It's not creating, which is beyond learning. This is just for learning, and no telling how long this is going to take us. So just be content with learning. Don't even worry about what's beyond learning. Don't even worry about that.
So okay? Has that been our problem here? We're trying to figure out how to do this, and we can't do that. We ask. We will be taught.
Yes, that's exactly right.
We're not going to get ourselves out of this, which is what I can hear us all sitting here trying to figure this out.
Yeah.
That's why we haven't got here.
Exactly.
So and give that up. Stop being the teacher.
Exactly. Stop being the teacher to
just
yourself.
Just ask Spirit. I need help here, you know.
Exactly. And so, and just bringing it back down to that totally practical level, whatever area of life that you are struggling in right now is an area that you have been trying to be your own teacher. You have been standing guard over your beliefs and your thought system and unwilling to let it be opened. And he says, and so he says, if you really are tired of struggling in this area, then he says, resign now as your own teacher. Resign now your role of guardian of your own thought system. Resign now as your own teacher and open your mind to the higher mind, your teacher with a capital T, and ask to be taught. Ask to learn anew. And then, now, when you say that, and that's your prayer, the door in your prison called this problem swings open. Yes.
Isn't it made all the more hard, all the more difficult because we don't really know what we don't know?
So it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter that you don't know what you don't know. All that matters is that you recognize you don't know. All that matters is that you recognize you don't know because you are not happy. That's all that matters, and that you are willing to learn of the teacher that does know. The teacher that is your higher mind. That's all that matters. Doesn't matter. Look, if you could know what you don't know, you wouldn't need a teacher. You wouldn't be unhappy. You wouldn't need learning. You wouldn't need teaching. Okay? Does that make sense?
But when you hear the truth, you'll know it.
Yes, you will know it. When you hear the truth, you will know it because you will be at peace. That is how you know. That is how you know. There is no knowledge without peace. Don't ever forget that. If you say you know what's going on, you know the truth of the matter, but you are not happy, you are wrong. But when you have peace, he says knowledge and peace are one. They do not go apart. Why? Because reality is from God, who is love, who is peace, who is happiness. So, if you have knowledge, you will have peace. If you know, you will have peace. You will have joy. So don't ever say, I know what this means. I know what they're doing. I know the truth about them. Or I know the truth about myself. And yet you're unhappy. Don't ever fool yourself like that. Right? But if you say, wow, I must not know the truth here because I'm not happy, boom. Now your mind is open to learning. And no mind that opens to learning ever, ever goes without being taught. The second you open your mind up to that, that's called an honest mind, immediately that mind receives the teaching that it needs in order to be happy, to have peace.
So it's interesting because as we're talking about this, this belief that I have, that I'm going to admit that I don't want another way of seeing it because
yes.
I'm like, even like talking about it brings terror to me. Like
yes.
This idea that I have to have this learned at a certain time because if I don't, then I stand damned.
Yes.
And like, I'm not willing to look at another way because what if that is the truth? What if I'm like, oh, okay, you could just take your time and I never learn.
Mm-hmm.
And then And then the time comes and like I die or whatever, and then God's like, well, what happened? You had all this time and you did not learn.
That's right.
And so now you're...
That's right. Exactly. Thank you for saying that, because here's something really crucial that he said that I want to emphasize, because I think it represents a major block to learning. Okay? So we're talking about major blocks to learning. And we need to know what those are, because learning is our only way out. Learning is our only hope. You say you want peace, you say you want happiness, you say you want health, you say you want abundance, you say you want love, you say you want freedom. It's not going to come from doing something different. It's only going to come from learning, opening your mind to change.
Is that
what the
Bible says, people perish without knowledge?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Yes, and so the crucial thing about removing those blocks to learning, which means change, is to remember this. When you open your mind to learning from your teacher, with a capital T, your higher mind, you need to remember, don't be afraid to do that, because he says, I never, ever, never, ever, ever, never, ever attack your ego. I need to know that, because I am not going to be open to listening to my teacher, especially when I feel like an idiot and I'm embarrassed for being so slow. Yeah. You know what I mean? It takes, you know, sometimes I don't want to open my mind to learning and say I don't know and say I need teaching because I'm embarrassed. I'm embarrassed to admit that I'm so wrong, right? I'm embarrassed to admit what I really think to my teacher, right? So it's crucial that you remember that your teacher will never, ever attack your ego. You don't have to be embarrassed. You don't have to feel ashamed to go, this is what I believe, oh my God, this is what I believe. I believe I'm not good enough. I believe nobody's good enough. I believe blah, blah, blah. Don't be afraid to say what you're really believing, that even though it's obvious.
Right.
Now, it's obvious that I don't love myself and I don't love anybody else, okay? It's obvious. But I'm ashamed to admit my ego thoughts. I'm ashamed. But if I was to remember, the truth is that when I go admit my ego thoughts, I want to murder that person, I hate myself, I hate them, I think I'm not good enough, I think they're not good enough, that my teacher will never, ever attack my ego. My teacher will never condemn me, shame me. My teacher will never say, ew, God, you still have those thoughts after all these years studying the course? God, ew. Okay, all right. You know, your teacher will never, ever, 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 ever attack your ego. And we need to know that, because otherwise we're going to feel too embarrassed and too ashamed and too afraid to open up what we believe, to stop standing guard over what we think enough to go, is that true, teacher? Is that really true? Do I really suck that bad? Now, if I think my teacher's going to condemn me or shame me, then I'm not going to say to my teacher, God, this is what I think. Do I really suck that bad? Am I really that horrible? I'm going to feel too ashamed to say that, to open my mind.
So then it's okay to admit that even after like 5 or so years of doing this, that I still do not believe a lot of this stuff.
How about 10 lifetimes of this and I still don't accept it? Right. You're still trying, you're trying to forgive yourself for not accepting it after 5 or 6 years. I may be having to deal with saying I still don't accept it after 10 lifetimes.
Wow.
So there. All right. Yeah. You think your persistence is so special, you know? I have to go to my teacher and go, oh, I still hate myself after 10 lifetimes of this, you know? Isn't that depressing to think that, heck, I was a monk in India in a cave 10 lifetimes ago? And I still have self-hatred. I still have hatred in my mind.
Well, for me, I have to change the terminology to get what I think you're telling us. Learning is change, you said at the time, but learning is listening.
Thank you. And opening.
I need to listen.
Yes.
Stop trying to teach myself what
yes.
to do here.
Right.
Just say, what do I do? Listen.
Right.
Shut up.
Shut up.
And
listen.
We're still busy talking, all of us.
We're so busy talking.
Just listen.
Yes.
Just shut up.
Exactly.
Let yourself be told, because you can't while you're talking.
Exactly. And so we want to tell ourselves, in this area that I'm really struggling because right now I'm standing guard over my thoughts about this. You know, I don't want to admit what I'm thinking. I don't want to hear anybody else's thoughts about it. I don't want to hear anything new about it. I don't want to hear anything different. I am standing guard over what I think about this problem. And it says, so that's what's going on. Because if you were not standing guard over what you were thinking about this problem and yourself, then your mind would be open and you'd be receiving learning. You'd be receiving a learning and you'd be experiencing a change. Change, aka freedom. Right? So basically what the attitude we want to take in whatever area of life we're really struggling with right now, the attitude we want to take is, I resign now as my own teacher in this area. I resign now as my own teacher relative to money. I resign now as my own teacher in the realm of relationships. I resign now as my own teacher in this area of life. Whatever it is, I don't know what it means. I don't know what it's for. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know who I am, and I don't know who they are. Yay! And I'm open to learning. And spirit, teach me. Higher mind, teach me a new way of seeing this. Teach me how you see it. Teach me what's the truth here. Thank you. That's how, now that's where real change comes from. That's where real freedom comes from. Freedom, change comes from learning. All right, let's stop here for tonight. Woo!
Wow.
Yay! Let's give it up for yourself for hearing new ideas. Yay! For not standing guard over your thought systems enough to come to class tonight. It's a miracle. It is a miracle anytime you stop standing guard over what you are telling yourself enough to hear something you hadn't been telling yourself. Do you realize that is a miracle? That is a miracle. So even if you think nothing has happened in this hour and a half, a miracle has occurred. Because you have to open your mind to learning to come to a class like this. Right? Because chances are good you've heard tonight something you were not telling yourself today about your problem. Correct? Chances are good. All right. Okay, so thank you for your financial expressions of appreciation. Thank you out there in YouTube land for your financial expressions of appreciation. So don't forget to go to my website, annakujawa.com, to learn about my holistic counseling practice. I do miracle psychotherapeutic sessions where we take what the course is saying and we apply them to those areas of your life where you need to learn something new so that you can experience a change that leads to greater freedom and joy and peace. And so I do those miracle psychotherapeutic sessions. I do them by Skype, by phone, or in person. So go to annakujawa.com. All right. Any other questions or comments before we close up? All right. Okay, so name one thing that you heard that you can do tonight with something that you've been struggling with. That's one thing you could do tonight.
Well, just be rigorously honest, because I know that my higher power or God will not attack my ego.
Yes.
So be honest, be like, I still don't have a clue and I still don't believe a lot of the stuff that I read.
Yes, beautiful. So I heard you say one thing you could do tonight is be honest about your ego, trusting that your teacher will never attack your ego. Beautiful. That's beautiful. Thank you.
It's about changing our perception and willing to look at things differently.
Yes,
changing
exactly.
Our perception of what?
Like Wayne Dyer says, when you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change.
Yes, beautiful. Exactly. Beautiful. What else? What's one thing you heard that you could do tonight?
And I'm going to listen.
You're going to listen.
I'm not going to make this happen like I've been trying to make it happen, but I can't allow it to happen.
Okay.
Me making it happen got me here.
Yes.
So listening is learning. That's, I can allow it, but
yes.
I need to change who's in charge here.
Yes. Beautiful. But yeah, change who the teacher is.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. What else? What's one
thing? The adult ego.
The adult ego
is so much stronger and deeply embedded than the youthful.
Yes. Yeah, a child is willing to say, I don't know, teach me. That's what it means, unless ye be come like a child, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. A child will say, I don't know, teach me. But an adult won't.
Yeah. Oh, I can't learn that, no.
Yeah, exactly. I can't
learn. I'm too old to learn.
Yeah, learning's for kids.
You can't teach an old dog new tricks.
Exactly. That's because an old dog don't want to learn. an old dog wants to be the teacher. Wow, interesting. So the miserable person that wants to be the teacher...
be miserable.
...will continue to be miserable. So, unless we become as little children relative to this problem, then we will keep this problem until this problem does us in. Oh, there's a new twist on that phrase. Wow. Yeah. Unless you become as a little children relative to this problem, then this problem will take you to your grave. Okay, so now we're going to do our integration meditation. And the integration meditation is where we take these ideas and we're going to use them. So what we're going to do is we're going to listen to some music. So what I want you to do is close your eyes. And just, I want you to just tune in to how you feel right now, having heard these ideas. And just breathe. And for a moment, just feel. Just feel what these ideas feel like in your mind, in your emotions, in your body. And just breathe. Beautiful. Now I want you to bring to your awareness an area of life where you recognize that you have not been exactly peaceful or happy in. You've been struggling in maybe the last few days, or a topic that you just can't seem to experience peace around that topic. No matter what you've been doing to try to change it. Issue, that problem. Look at it. What does it look like? What does it feel like? And I want you to tell yourself, I must be wrong about this because I'm not happy. I'm not happy about it. I'm not happy in it. I must be wrong about it. And then I want you to tell yourself, I want a change. I want to experience some real change. I want to experience some real change. Real change. I'm tired of this. I'm tired of suffering in this way. I'm really, really tired of struggling with this still after all this time. Tell yourself, I'm ready for a change. And then I want you to tell yourself, and I want you to tell your teacher, I want you to tell your higher mind teacher, teacher, I am ready to resign now as my own teacher in this area of my life. I'm ready to look at what I've taught myself in this area. I'm ready to question it. I'm ready to open it up to you, to your teaching. I'm ready to learn a new teacher. And then I want you to just do a brief inventory of some of the beliefs that you obviously have taught yourself about this topic. Be honest with yourself. Be honest with your beliefs around this topic that you're still suffering with. Be honest about your ego. Means be honest about your beliefs and the things you're telling yourself around this topic. Be honest. Don't worry, your teacher is not going to attack your ego. And then tell yourself honestly, I must be wrong because I don't like the way I feel. And then tell your teacher, I am asking for another way of looking at this, teacher. Please teach me another way of seeing this and seeing myself. Ask with all the sincerity that you can muster in your heart. I'm really ready for a change in this area, teacher. I need a change. I want it. I need it. There's got to be a better way, teacher, of dealing with this situation. There's got to be a better way, and I'm asking for it. I don't know what the truth is in this situation. I don't know the truth about myself. I don't know the truth about them. I don't know what I am. I don't know what I'm doing, and I don't know what this is really for. And please, teacher, teach me what it means, what it's for, and what it is. Teach me the truth here, now. I want to learn anew about this, about myself. And I trust you, teacher, that if I will be honest about my beliefs and my thoughts and my ego, that you will not attack my ego and you will teach me the truth of this matter and will free me from the prison I made of it. And then just practice listening. Just listen. Your teacher will never, ever, ever refuse this prayer. And then I want you to tell your teacher, teacher, thank you. I trust you. I trust that you've heard my prayer for learning. I trust that you've heard my prayer for new learning in this situation. And I trust that you have answered me, and that even if I do not receive your answer right now, that I will in time. And I thank you in advance for your answer. I thank you in advance for never failing to give me that new learning when I ask for it. And teacher, I resign now as my own teacher. I renounce the role of guardian of my thought system around this topic. And I open my mind back to you, back to learning from you and only you. Thank you, teacher. And I want you to feel your gratitude to your teacher fill your heart and flood your body. Breathe in your teacher's presence and breathe in your teacher's love. Feel the fact of your teacher's love and your teacher's presence. You are truly not alone. Never was, never could be, never will be. You are always, always, always indwelt and heard by your teacher, your higher mind, who knows you and loves you, and hears your every request for learning. And I want you to tell yourself, I am entitled to change. I am entitled to learning. Back to the room and back to your body. All right, you guys, thank you, thank you, thank you. That was so wonderful. Thank you, thank you, thank you for being here and helping us all to hear that message from our teacher. I appreciate you guys. Thank you, thank you. Thank you out there in YouTube land. Appreciate you guys. I'll see you next time I see you.